Welcome back. It is still Women's Month, and yes, this is another episode of The Checkpoint with me, Lynn Komjisha. Today, like I said at the start, I'm very privileged. It's not my first time to sit down with this wonderful lady. Every time I get to sit down with her, it's amazing. So I have with me Dr. and Honorable Miria Rukoza Kobulunga Matembe. Yes, we are conversating. I borrowed that word. Meanwhile, I'm learning these days. Conversating. We're having a conversation. We're having a conversation about women empowerment, which has been a core of her activism, and we're trying to look at encompassing women empowerment and the latest developments in the world, and how we can all be part of this conversation. Now, when we went for a break, we're looking at, is women empowerment good for marital and family stability? And she was like, yes, it is amazing. Doctor,
it is the best.
It is the best, that's what she said. But doctor, there's a clash of worlds here. How can women empowerment and then family stability?
You see, when you say empowerment, and you keep using that word empowerment,
yes,
then I think maybe it is misunderstood. We should have actually maybe defined empowerment. Because empowerment can be defined in many ways, but when we talk of women empowerment, we mean that you give women ability and the capacity to take decisions about their lives, about their families, about their nation. You get the ability and the capacity. The ability, of course, the ability and capacity necessarily comes from knowledge.
Exposure
and power. Power, knowledge, economic power, and you know, being recognized and accepted as also a full human being in your right, capable of utilizing your talents, your wisdom to realize your potential. Mm-hmm. It comes from a background that a woman is also a human being. She has God-given wisdom, God-given talents, God-given potential. But because of the constraints that women face, the discrimination, culture, whatever, which I had listed already, they are denied the opportunity to
enjoy this right.
Yes, to advance, to nurture, mm-hmm, their talents, their wisdom, develop their wisdom and understanding, and utilize it first for themselves. Because as a girl, you need to also do things for yourself.
Yeah.
And then for your family, assuming you have already married, mm-hmm, and then for your community, and for your nation. In other words, you are treated as a half human being. And therefore, you are not empowered, yes, to do that which God created you to do. Now, when you are asking me, is women's empowerment good for marriage and family? I'll say yes. Why? Because when God created a man, he saw that he could not be alone. He was helpless. So he went to his side here and picked a rib which is a harder substance, harder than clay. It was from the rib. It was a finer material. And he said, you helpless man, this is your helper. Where did God get the rib, which is tougher, which is harder? When you need help, you lean on a tougher. Now, it is this very person now who God created to empower the man and be his helper that is now disempowered. Now, when you disempower this woman, you are disempowering the man. You are disempowering everybody, because God created this person to empower, to help the otherwise helpless man. Now, when you disempower and you don't recognize her as a full human being, moreover, with even better capacity because she comes from a tougher substance. Let me tell you what I'm telling you has evidence here. You get a man with no wife and you see how they behave and see who they are. In fact, in my culture, you just say that he's a boy in a house. But the moment he marries tonight, that house becomes a home. And I'm telling you, things change. From there and then, things change. Now, you can imagine when you go and marry a woman who is educated, who is employed, who understands, who knows how to rear children, who knows how to plan, who can participate in your decisions to advance you. How can you say that such would not be a happy marriage? You would have got your helper. And let me tell you, men, I even tell women, please don't look for your help from men because they are already helpless. You came to help them. Look for your help from your creator. God is the main helper of women. For me, I tell women, I am created to help Matembe. I will tell you the challenge of men. I'm created to help Matembe, and my God who created me will help me.
Yes.
So I lean on my God. He gives me ideas. He gives me potential. He gives me ability and wisdom, which I push into this otherwise lacking man. He was not full. He was not complete. He was lacking something. And God said, no, you are lacking. I'm creating you a suitable helper. You cannot the material through from which the woman was made. And from he didn't go to the clay. He didn't go to the feet. He didn't go to the bottom that they sit on us. He went to the side. And it's meaningful purpose that we must side exist side by side with men. And let me tell you, if men were to allow that, if society were to allow that, any man who understands that this woman is a helper and he relies and depends on her ideas and maybe policies and guidance, they come out a better family.
Wonderful.
I am telling you, it is there. But the challenge with men now is we are supposed to help them. In other words, they were created to have the goals for the family. And me, I'm supposed to help you in advancing and achieving these goals.
This also
but you find men who has no goal. They have no purpose. They are just there. They are just there like Adam. Do you know when Adam ate the fruit? I was asking, when Eva brought the fruit and Adam ate it, when Eva was there languishing in the garden looking for this unsuitable companion whom he found, where was Adam? And the Bible says that Adam was also there with her. Some of these men are just there. No dream, no purpose, no goal, no nothing. And I want to ask you, the Bible says, yes, submit to your husband. Now I want to ask, the husband is there, no goal, no purpose, no nothing. When I submit to him, where do we go? How am I supposed to submit to him? I submit to my God, and my God gives me direction,
right,
and I run this family. If I run it well for you, well and good, why do you care? I have run it. The children have gone to school. You are eating the houses we have built. What do they want? That they fall short of men. Am I the one who has made him fall short of a man? If for a woman to come and overtake the husband,
yes,
you know the husband had
has
failed.
Has a problem.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Otherwise, they come in to fill the gap.
I worry for our girls looking up to you and very many other women who run to these helpless men because they have money. That is another conversation.
That is another conversation. And by the way, to prove what I'm saying, when they say that equality breaks marriages, in this country, I'm not hating myself, but at least I know I'm one of those greatest who with a passion who run with this battle wholesale. But I am married for the last 46 years,
and it's very interesting.
And I'm not going to say that marriage is just roses. No, it is a garden of roses. It is not just flowers. It is a garden of roses. And a garden of roses has thorns.
Absolutely.
It has thorns. It attracts animals and insects.
And bees.
And therefore, you need to understand. You need to have strategies. Which how to prune, how to
maybe get rid of the thorns.
You garden, prune and trim and the manure, and you cut the leaves and you do all this thing to nurture this garden where you will get beautiful flowers. And it takes two of you to do that. For me, people say, you know, this man Matembe has suffered. How does he manage this woman? And I say, why should I be managed? Am I a factory? Am I a project? Am I an office that I need management? I'm a human being that need love and understanding. You offer the love of understanding and we move.
That's
and
so
you
good.
Terrorize my ability and my capacity and my energy to fly.
Why is it so hard?
Instead of trampling on me and you trample together downhill.
Thank you for that, because I don't understand men. What's wrong? What's wrong with you understanding and loving us the way we are? Anyway, let's move on to something else, Doctor. The issue of mentorship. You've already highlighted that you have a lady, a girl, you're mentoring.
Yeah, many of them.
Now, I wonder, is mentorship really an intervention to addressing gender inequalities?
I think actually mentorship is a principle which means building others.
Yes.
You take a path, mm-hmm. and you have knowledge, you have wisdom, you have capacity, you have potential, you have succeeded in life. And by the way, success to me does not mean mincing wealth and positions and so on. Success to me, by the way, means knowing God's purpose for your life and serving it.
Absolutely.
And living like, I call myself, I'm a role model. By the way, in 1998, I received an international award as one of 100 women world over, who by 1998, had acted as role model to women world over with courage, with commitment, and had modeled so many women in the world. So that's the person you are talking with.
Yes.
That's who I am. Now, if I am that, God in I think it is John chapter 16, verse 15 in the Bible, it says that I'm the one who chose you and appointed you,
yes,
to bear fruits that would last. That is the mentoring. That is the influence.
Mm.
God created each of us to bear fruit. If he had wanted us to bear fruit, just the ones we eat and finish, he would not have repeated fruits that will last.
Mm-hmm.
He wants you to bear fruits that will last. In other words, you are created and positioned for influence. And so, when you have started bearing fruits, you should be able to bear those which last by influencing others, by mentoring others. By the way, you may mentor people. I have so many people call me mentees. I've not sat with them and mentored them.
Mm-hmm.
But because of how I behave, because of what I say, because of listening, for instance, like this program, you don't know what it means. It makes such a difference. I remember I used to go to primary and address young girls. And eventually I met a girl who was studying PhD.
Yes.
And he ran after me and said, "Honorable, you came to our primary school in Bunyaruguru when I was in P6. He said, after you talked to us, you shared your story, that's the first time I knew I, as a girl, was also a human being.
Mm.
So that one, am I not her mentor?
Absolutely.
So mentoring, I take it as influence. And I say, it is good for every area. Mentor people in agriculture, mentor them in engineering, mentor them in all aspects of life. So in gender equality and women's empowerment, is also mentoring is also good. Because they see you have succeeded, you should not go with your success. If I succeed and go, who will run with my mantle?
Mm.
You must, somebody must run in generations. Even the word of God talks of generation. There is Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I'm so glad and I thank God that me now, I have already, as a Matembe family, we also have three generations already. So if I go now, my father went, I'm here, and I have my son. And if I go now, my son and daughters are rearing the other generations. We must hand over pin, hand over mantles to those who come after us if we are to move forward. Therefore, mentoring is also very important for every struggle, for every field. So for gender equality and women's empowerment, mentoring is important. And why it is important, actually, we should now even, reactivate the type of mentoring that we should have. You know, long ago, we used to have to run mobilization on gender sensitization, and it was actually gender sensitization and conscientization, to tell them what we mean by women's empowerment and gender equality. The problem that has happened now, the women now who have come after us, they have missed out on that gender awareness and conscientization programs, which used to tell both men and women what we mean by gender equality and women's empowerment. Now the young women and men have missed it. They are losing out on it. They have narrowed it down to gender equality and women's empowerment, meaning the man can cook also. The man can also take care of children. A woman can also build a house. They have just put it around right responsibilities just like that, when it should be building up a wholesome, complete human being in form of a man and a woman to be able to exist as God had wanted us to exist. You know what? The problem was that the devil came and destroyed God's original plan. God's original plan, let me tell you, for a family, was that the man was created, he was helpless, and God created a suitable helper for him so that two of them must exist equally, side by side with one another. And God was their boss, and Satan was the devil under their foot. Now, when there was sin, things changed. There was turnover of events. You know, first of all, the devil took control of the human being. We are under devil. Until you accept Jesus Christ and reconciled with God, you are being ruled by a devil. And therefore, many families which are not submitting to God now, the devil is the ruler. And in a family where the devil is the ruler, the man rules over the woman. Because the command was, man shall rule over you.
Yes.
The man rules over the woman. And now they have no connection with God.
Right.
So they are lost. But those who are restored, you know, like me now, now that I know Jesus Christ reconciled me with God, the situation was restored. I'm now side by side with Matembe, and it is God who is our master, and the devil is under my feet. And that's how I would like all families to be. That's how I would like. And that's why, by the way, when I received Jesus Christ as my Savior, I met God myself, and he said, what does it gain you when you deliver women and you liberate them physically and you lose them by soul, you lose their souls? I woke up, I said, hey, these women are going to be equal, empowered, enjoy rights and so on, and then their souls will go to hell. I said, no. Now I receive Jesus Christ, now my soul is redeemed, therefore now my empowerment program is captured and all engraved into the word of God.
Absolutely.
Because he's our creator.
What is your take on men who mentor women?
For instance, I want to ask you. You see, mentorship should not gender, genderize it. Because if my boss is a man, and he sees I'm a very good person in this engineering or in accounts, and he takes time to nurture me and make me a better accountant, What's wrong with that?
The men of these days, doctor.
I don't know these days for me. I don't know. Let me tell you, I've been retired for the last 16 years. So when I don't know what's wrong with men of days, what do you mean? You mean sexual harassment? You mean what?
Well,
what?
With all that comes.
But mentoring, what does mentoring mean? Uh-huh. Mentoring means you get time to nurture somebody.
Come under the guise of mentoring.
No, that's wrong. I mean, that is, you, mentoring is not sexual harassment. Mentoring is not sexual submission. Mentoring, to me, mentoring has nothing to do with sex. Mentoring is helping somebody, nurturing somebody to do better than they were doing, and you are mentoring them in the field which you are all knowledgeable and you have flared and flown with it, and
absolutely
you are an expert.
I like that,
of that.
At least you have, you know, clarified on that. Now, as we get to the end of the show, I came across certain conversations on social media. Somebody was saying there is a difference between having women in positions of power without power and having women in positions of power with power.
Actually, I thought it was my statement.
This is by Nabagabe Karure, Flavia Kasanda.
Oh, she's getting it from
MP.
My book. And all. That is my mentee.
Oh, you know her? Perfect. Uh-huh.
Nabagabe is my mentee.
That's
so
good.
If she says women are there without power, she has got it from the right person.
Mm.
Because power, you cannot have power. You cannot call yourself a leader unless you have influence. You must be able to influence decisions.
Right.
To make them responsive to what you want.
Mm.
Now, in Uganda right now, we have so many women in positions of power.
Mm.
And it has been, the affirmative action has,
yes,
can be counterproductive.
Yes.
The one in Uganda is now counterproductive. It has been hijacked and used to just put women in positions of power without power, but say, yes, women are there. You women, what do you want? You are there. We are there. What influence do we have? Let me tell you, when we want women to participate in decision making and in leadership, we want them to participate effectively by influencing decisions to make them responsive to the whole issue of gender equality and women's empowerment. What are the decisions that are made, for instance, in Prime Minister's office when it comes to equality and empowerment of women?
Mm.
What decisions are there in the Ministry of Health, in the Ministry of Education, in the Ministry of, right now, tell me, we have a whole first lady who is the Minister of Education, and we have 15,000 girls who were impregnated, defiled and raped. Some of them have delivered, some of them have not delivered, some of them I don't know where they are. For us in with UGANET, we established the home where we were keeping them and sustaining them. I don't know whether now that COVID is gone, I haven't gone to see where they are now. I want you to tell me, have you heard of any special activity, any special policy, any special program announced even publicly so that women, wherever they are of that character, can go and benefit?
There was something from the Ministry of Education about allowing them to go back to school.
What are you telling me
and,
now?
You know,
first of
them.
All, Terry, yes, killing. What you are saying there was something. Where is it? Where is it? I want you to show me where
was
is it.
Policy.
Which decision
was
has been made?
Was put
where
out.
Was it and what has it done so far? How many girls now do we know? I want to ask you. Do we know how many of these 14,000? Do we know how many who have delivered? Do we know where their babies are? Do we know where the girls are? In which schools where they are? Do we know? And I want to ask you, which women have you had combined together, working together like we used to do, to come to hold the Minister of Education to account, to come and address us and say, okay, there is a policy. How much money have you injected? How much programs are they having? Where are the babies? What have you done to the traumatized women whose children became pregnant by their fathers, by their uncles? Where are they? Where are these women?
It's a global problem.
Who is caring about them? Don't take me global. Global, they have policies. Global, they have decisions.
Anyway,
global, they know what they've done.
Right.
Am I not here challenging? Let any woman come, because I'm challenging those women leadership. Mm-hmm. Let them come now, bring them here. And they tell you specifically that these kind of women were in these schools, you know, because when you are to take decisions, you must do survey, must do research. We should now know who are they. Like I was trying to guide some of the women in parliament that, you know, if you want to help the women, mothers in the villages where their children got pregnant and so on, because they are very traumatized. Many families have broken down. They are disempowered. Let me tell you, if there were women in decision-making positions, there should have been prioritization of public expenditure. Having seen COVID, the trauma it caused, the chaos it caused here, you don't leave a family as it is. I want you to tell me which policy has focused on the family and say, you know, the families were traumatized, some of them were battered, marriages broke, children, you know.
Maybe it's not entirely up to government. It's entirely up to us as women.
I am saying, why should anything be on me as a woman? You know, one thing I want to put forward is, which I have already said, the struggle for gender equality and women's empowerment is not for the benefit of women alone, is for the benefit of society. I've told you, society is held by women. So women hold society on their heads, I'm telling you. And if they are not empowered and strengthened the society will remain the way it is. We have said it again and again. And therefore, for me, if we were the women who were there, who used to shout and talk, the family would be a priority on the government expenditure now. We would have said, you people, during COVID, who were hit first? Families.
Women.
Don't say women only. Families were hit very badly. Mm. So after COVID, what decisions, what policies, where have we placed a human, a family, in the priority of government expenditure? Where are they? Even when they say go back to school, they're telling them go back to school. The children, the parents don't have school fees. If anything, they have married women. Girls have been coming to me running to hide in my home, and some parents running after them, especially those who want cows. And they take them and marry them out. And they are saying, since these girls are getting married at 16, 14, mine are also going to marry. Why don't I get cows now? That's what is going on. And if women were in positions of power, since they are there, because like in from government, we have out of president, vice president, prime minister, and I think three prime ministers. Four of those are women. Four of those people are women, but I can assure you and tell you that they have no decisions to make. I don't think that they have power to make decisions that can influence.
What has gone
wrong?
Because you and fellow other women have fought for all this, but we are not seeing it happen. There's been a lot of noise, and we're not seeing real action and progress.
You see, the environment has changed so much. I must tell you that we are acting in a political environment which is no longer conducive. One thing I found out is that the extent to which women can influence decisions affecting their lives, their communities, and their nations depend on the prevailing political environment in the country and the political will. If the political environment is very conducive for women's free and proper equal participation, to express, to exercise their right to express the whatever, and there is political will to promote that, then women participate effectively and decisions are made and things are different. But the moment the environment changes in such a way that leadership is about self-centeredness, if the leadership is just self-centeredness, just getting power to be in power forever for my own good, that is the nature of the leadership that we have now. And it is not from the president only, but from the president through all levels of leadership. It is about self, It has nothing to do with human, not human-centeredness. For us, when we are running with this kind of reading, we were looking at society, community, changing societies, empowering them. But now the idea of leadership is focused. Disempower as many people as you can so that you rule them forever. Disempower okay. as many as you can, men
Doctor,
and women.
Doctor,
disempower.
We are out of time. What is your concluding remark?
Concluding remark
on this conversation.
In this whole conversation is that on the issue of gender equality and women's empowerment, we are now in reverse. We are not progressing the way we used to progress. And of course, COVID pandemic has made the situation worse, but mainly the political environment, which is not conducive, which is about self-centeredness and power orientation, has nothing to care about to citizens whom they lead. We are in reverse. But I do not think that it will end. Once a journey has started, it may slow down, it may stale, but it will not go backward.
Absolutely.
Now, the general thing is about the general political environment in the country is very, very unfortunate, is very, very bad. It is driven, we went to the bush and fought for freedom and democracy in this country. The political environment is so militaristic. The political space has been conscripted. The civil space is not there anymore. Everybody who talks sense and talk truth must be silenced. They must be put in prison. There's no freedom of expression, no freedom of humanity, of human being in this country.
So a woman
and
can't
once
flourish.
It is like that, women are worse. Because women can flourish in a political environment which is peaceful.
Wow.
The moment it becomes violent and unpeaceful, they shy off it.
Okay, all right. You've heard from the Honorable Dr. Miriam Matembe, and it was an honor having you. And for the ladies out there, I'm sure you've picked a thing or two, especially one that says men are helpless and so we are the helpers. And you keep running to them for money and you're saying, you know what, I'm not talking to you because you don't have a car, instead of running to God. Wow, wonderful. Thank you. We'll catch you again in another episode of The Checkpoint. Do have yourselves a wonderful time and God bless you.